Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning at Forge Road Bible Chapel, both here and at home and online. I trust that you're going to find our discussion to be interesting and profitable and intelligent, and so that you can say that this has been a good use of an hour. We're going to start this morning in the book of Acts and chapter 16. Acts chapter 16. Now, we are today starting a new series of meetings that is going to take us through 12 weeks. And as Norris has told you, it will include meetings both at our Family Bible Hour and later on in February, time set aside on Friday evenings for discussion of some of the specific chapters. Our subject is Paul's letter that we call 1 Corinthians. Our purpose today is to set the scene, set the context, and then to cover the first 9 verses of the book. But we're going to start our discussion here in Acts chapter 16 and with verse 11. Acts 16, verse 11. Therefore, sailing from Troas, we ran a straight course to Samothrace, and on the next day, came to Neapolis. May the Lord bless and give us a good understanding as we consider his word. We mark history by landmark events, sometimes a beginning, sometimes a culmination, sometimes a transition of some important movement. And sometimes, and usually, those big events occur on a predetermined schedule. They're anticipated, they're expected, and they are prepared for. Later this week, the they, Paul and Silas and Timothy and any with them, they have gone to Perga and Galatia, and they tried to go to Bithynia. But between verses 8 and 10, the they had become a we, because now Luke, the author of this historic narrative, had joined the company. So now the we that were with Paul were at Troas, and it's hard to explain in just a few words and to demonstrate the importance of that moment, but I'm hoping that we have a map that would help. Are we close? So let me tell you what the map is going to show, and then we'll get it up to, can I advance? Am I? There you go. This is like hearing the message again. Well, that's great, Bill. Thank you. That's great. You can see there how the Holy Spirit, as I said, during that second missionary journey, pushed Paul and his company further and further and further west, all the way to the port city of Troas. Can I have this? And you see there the verses that I just referred, that transition from the third person, that they had gone through Perga and Galatia, and now we sought to go to Macedonia. So we are now at Troas. And let's take a look at this map. Now, I'm sorry for how busy this looks. The day of Pentecost is recorded in Acts chapter 2. And there Luke explains that in Jerusalem, gathered for that feast, were devout Jews from, in Luke's words, every nation under heaven. There were Parthians and Medes and Elamites and those dwelling in Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia and Perga and Pamphylia and Egypt and parts of Cyrene, parts of Libya joining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, Cretans and Arabs, and they all heard in their own language the wonderful works of God. They all heard that the promises that God had made to the fathers, he had now fulfilled by raising up Jesus. And this map illustrates the list from Acts chapter 2 to show you where those Parthians and Medes and Elamites and those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Perga, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Cyrene, and parts of Libya joining Cyrene, where they were from. That list is a pretty good indication of where there were substantial Jewish populations, which means for Paul's purposes, where there would be a working knowledge of the scriptures, the law and the prophets, where there would be an understanding of the promises and the purposes of God from which Paul could build the gospel message and reach the people of the region. Notice how prevalent was the traditional Jewish population in the regions Paul has been to. Notice how absent it is in Macedonia and Greece. Paul is now here. And this map shows at a glance what it would take a social scientist hours to explain. Behind him was a world familiar. What lay across those waters was Macedonia, the homeland and the stronghold of Greek culture, where Aristotle had tutored Alexander the Great. And in great big geopolitical terms, what lay across those waters was the Western world. We still consider the Dardanelles to be the dividing line between East and West. And across those waters lay a different world. Behind Paul was a world of traditional religion, Across those waters was a world of science and technology. Behind him lay a world that valued the wisdom of the elders. Across those waters was a world of education and ever-changing social values, a world of vigorous political public debate, of public theater, and of endless sporting games. Behind Paul was a world that valued the ancient and established way. Ahead was a world that wanted everything new all the time. Luke writes in Acts 17 that they spent their time in nothing else but to tell and to hear whatever was the newest new thing. Everybody had to have the newest version of something. Behind Paul was a world steeped in the old, where generations waited their turn to continue the established way. Ahead of him was a world that celebrated being young and where new generations pushed out the old. Over those waters was a world that favored action over contemplation, science over mystery, youth over age, logic over tradition, and commerce over everything. Across those waters was the Western world, the world that you and I live in. To reach the people of that different world, Paul was going to have to do things in a different way. He was going to have to stand in Athens and preach not from the words of Jewish prophets, but he was going to have to preach from the words of Greek poets. He would have to abandon the synagogues for a new form of evangelism, one that would happen in the marketplaces and in the workplaces and in homes. He would have to forge a new type of discipleship. Paul had been a Jew to the Jews. Now he's got to become a Greek to the Greeks. It would be as if on February 20, 1962, John Glenn orbited the Earth three times, and upon receiving instructions to return for splashdown, he instead pointed Friendship 7 towards the moon. And I know the physics doesn't work, but the imagery does. The history of the world knows very few events as important as the infusion of the gospel of Jesus Christ into Greek and Western culture. And it started when Paul, with those with him, sailing from Troas, arrived in Neapolis, stepped off that ship, and into Macedonia. Now, upon arrival, Paul and his group moved quickly through the cities, as had been his practice before, sometimes pushed by persecution, sometimes just to keep moving, through Philippi and Thessalonica and Berea and Athens. But then he came to Corinth, and in Corinth, he did something that he had not done before. He stayed. He stayed there for 18 months. He worked as a tent maker with Aquila and Priscilla. His base was not the local synagogue, but the home of Titus Justus, a Gentile. And after Paul left Corinth, he stayed in close touch with the church. And over the next 7 years, he would have a more extended, more well-documented, and more volatile relationship with the Corinthian Christians than with any other church. He would make at least two more substantial visits there. He would write his most famous letter of all, the Epistle to the Romans, that would be written from Corinth. This letter, the study of which we start today, was written from the city of Ephesus during Paul's third missionary journey. Now, we call this letter 1 Corinthians, but it's not the first letter Paul wrote back to them. The letter itself refers to one that was prior. And over the years, Paul would write at least four letters to the Corinthians, two of which we have in our Bibles, and the other two which have been lost. And now, as we come to this letter in 1 Corinthians, the church at Corinth is having problems. And I mean, they are having a lot of problems. And those problems have caused dissensions and disagreements that have manifested themselves in all sorts of ways, from doctrinal disputes to personal animosity to arguments about the Lord's Supper to questions about public and private morality. even to lawsuits suing one another. And now, dealing with these questions and problems, these Corinthian Christians, they were at a great disadvantage as compared to us in such matters, because they didn't have the New Testament to read. Very little of it had been written. None of the Gospels had been written. None of Peter's letters, none of John's letters, not Acts, not Hebrews. Actually, 1 Corinthians is the fifth book written from Ephesus, is the fifth book of what would become the canon. In order of writing, it's James, Galatians, which are written right after the first missionary journey, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, which were written during the second journey, and then 1 Corinthians. Now think about that for just a minute. The Gospels are placed first in our canon, and that's the way we sort of read through, and we sort of think that the life of Jesus would have been the first thing that was written down, but it wasn't. The early letters of Paul are all written before any of the Gospels, which means, for instance, that the first written record that Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you." The first written record of that is in 1 Corinthians. The earliest written record of Jesus Christ having been raised again on the third day, having been seen of Cephas and the 12 and 500 brethren, the first written event, the first written record of the event of the resurrection is in 1 Corinthians. Now that understanding alone should compel our attention to this book. So these Corinthian Christians are at a disadvantage as to us, in that they can't refer to the Gospels or to Romans or Ephesians or Hebrews to answer their questions. But if they had a great big disadvantage compared to us in that they didn't have the New Testament, they had a great big advantage in that they still had contact with Paul himself. They couldn't look up what he wrote in Romans and Ephesians, but they could ask him directly. Now, for better or for worse, I serve here as an elder. And there have been numerous times after studying a portion of Romans or Ephesians or 1 Corinthians as it impacts us at Forge Road Bible Chapel, I thought how much easier it would be if I could just ask Paul directly. These Corinthian Christians could. And in fact, they did. They had written Paul a letter, which you see referenced beginning in chapter 7, with a laundry list of questions. And at the end of the book, Paul refers to three men, Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaeus, who came from Corinth. And maybe they were the ones who brought the letter. Also, about this time, Paul had gotten another communication from Corinth. He refers to this in chapter 1. It's from the household of Chloe, and they've also talked about problems and raised questions. Now, with Paul at Ephesus is a man named Sothenesis. Historians disagree, but there's a man of the same name at Corinth, and he shows up in Acts 18, and he was a Jew who sided with Paul, who caused and that had caused great upset. If this is the same man, then it's not hard to imagine him joining Paul on his travels and being with him in Ephesus. It's not hard to imagine Paul having gotten this letter from Corinth, having heard from the household of Chloe, that they sit down together and that they work through these questions and write this letter together. And that's how 1 Corinthians proceeds. There's a greeting that we'll cover in a few minutes. And then Paul starts to write about the things that have been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household. And we'll start those next week, and they will go through chapter 6. And then chapter 7 begins, now concerning the things which you have written to me, or which you wrote to me. And it starts to address the letters that were in his, the issues that were raised in that letter. And you're going to notice as we go through the phrase now concerning 5 times. Now concerning spiritual gifts. Now concerning things sacrificed to idols. And he and his response to the issues that they've raised. One by one until we get to chapter 16 and then a conclusion and a sign off. All of this comes together. Paul's 18 months in the city. Their continuing communication with him. The list of practical questions, the report from Chloe, the presence of a man who knew the city well, all of it comes together to create what for us is the best handbook or manual, if I can use those words, for the operation of the church that's ever been written. And that's certainly one way to read and study 1 Corinthians, with answers to practical questions that set us on the right course. And that's important, and we'll certainly do that together. But we need to take more than that from this book and from this study. We need to know not only what are the right answers so that we can repeat them back, we need to know why they're the right answers. For 1 Corinthians explains not just how we function within the church, but how the church functions within a city and how the gospel still impacts our Hellenistic world. So, let's gather around as they did and listen with expectant ears as they did, as this letter has come from Paul and as the church has assembled to hear it.
Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother, to the church of God, which is at Corinth, and to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all who in every place call on the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Grace to you. And peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given you by Christ Jesus, that you were enriched in everything by him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm you to the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
That is all.
Essentially American. Birthed in 1927 in the musical Showboat, from the best-selling novel by Edna Ferber, with music by Jerome Kern, book and lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein Jr., and produced by Florence Ziegfeld, who was maybe the only man in America who had the resources, the connections, the stature, and the courage to pull it off. Showboat was something like no one had ever seen before. It took the American tradition of musical follies, with pretty girls, lovely melodies, and flowing costumes, and combined that with the power of European opera, with songs like Old Man River. And by the way, Showboat has been done by the best opera companies in America, from the San Francisco Opera to the DC National Opera, and then it added something neither the Follies or the opera ever had. Real characters who you understood and cared about, and a real plot that dealt with serious social issues. It is generations before its time. It unloads with a story that breaks your heart, and songs that move the plot and convey the emotions. These shots are from the promotional and also from the dress rehearsal the night before, before opening night. Talk about history happening when no one expects it to. During the pre-Broadway tour, crowds that gathered expecting to see the latest rendition of the Ziegfeld Follies just sat stunned throughout the play. They didn't clap, they didn't cheer, they didn't boo. They just sat there, even at the end of the play. They didn't know what to do. Nobody had ever seen anything like this before. And Ziegfeld was convinced that he had a flop on his hands. He considered tearing the show down and re-releasing just the comedy and the light musical numbers. But word spread, and the reviews rolled in, and it played to packed houses night after night. And when it opened on Broadway on December 27, 1927, everyone knew that anything previously done on the American musical stage was now obsolete, and that a new art form had been born. Today, if you see a musical on stage or in the movies, Broadway or in a high school, be it Guys and Dolls or West Side Story or Chicago or Oklahoma or Fiddler on the Roof or Hamilton, you are watching the children, the grandchildren, and the great-grandchildren of Showboat. Showboat opens with what we call an overture, the standard opening for most musical numbers. That's what you're listening to now. The overture takes the songs of the show and blends them together into a medley. It signals the beginning of the show. It sets the tone. It sets out familiar chords, all to let us know what's coming, previewing the songs that we're going to hear. And it gets us emotionally ready to laugh or cry, to cheer or to hurt as the writers intended. Now, I don't know how this is sounding at home on Zoom, but I expect that there are more than a few people here who are thinking, will this guy please just stop talking and let us listen to some of the greatest music ever written in America. I want you to think of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 9, as the overture of this book. It takes all the themes that we're going to hear throughout the text, and it weaves them into a medley of thought to introduce the concepts. As in an overture, Paul gives us the first few bars of the songs that we're going to hear later on, the first few words of the themes that he's going to develop as this letter progresses. The first thing we're going to hear is that of Christian unity. And here in the overture, Paul sounds those first notes of our oneness in Christ. It is a unity of love and cooperation with one another in our local assembly. That's the word that Paul uses. What's translated church is the word ekklesia, meaning a people assembled for a particular purpose. They are the church of God, the assembly at Corinth, as we are the assembly at Forge Road. But our unity extends beyond our own meeting. It is a unity of purpose of all those who in every place call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. He is our Lord, and he is their Lord, and that single feature dwarfs any differences that there may be from person to person, from church to church, from place to place. Unity is a theme that Paul is going to swell as we go through this series, starting as early as next week. As Paul pleads with them in the name of the Lord Jesus, that they all speak the same thing and that they all mind the same thing, that there be no divisions and that they be perfectly joined together in one mind and in one judgment. A second theme after unity is sanctification. Christians, by definition, are those who have been set apart by Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ unto salvation. And having been sanctified for eternity, we are to live sanctified lives, lives that are holy unto the Lord. Sanctification in life, again, is a theme, the first notes of which are sounded in this overture, but we are going to hear throughout this letter. Paul calls on the Corinthians for us to live holy and righteous lives. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And in this letter, Paul talks about marriage. He talks about a husband and a wife giving honor to one another and affection and fidelity to one another, rejecting worldly standards and living in purity, walking before God in all that we do. Unity, sanctification, and the richness of the Christian life. The Christian life is one of sanctification, but it is not one of scarceness. To the contrary, Paul writes that we are enriched in everything by Christ, as Jesus said, to have life and to have it abundantly, and there is nothing better than being a Christian. Being a Christian ennobles and enriches everything in life. And we hear these first few notes in the overture, so Paul is going to write to us in chapter 10 that whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. In chapter 8 and chapter 9, we're going to explore the vastness of the liberty that is given to us to rejoice in what is sometimes called the common grace of God that blesses this world of sin, the majesty of the creation, the beauty of art, the genius of intellect, the nobility of struggle. Paul writes in chapter 2 that we will, through God's Spirit, understand and appreciate all things that are freely given to us by God. So in this overture, we hear the medley of unity, of sanctification, of richness in life, and also our working together in spiritual gift. Paul writes to the Corinthians that your church comes short in no gift. The Corinthians, spiritually, had everything they needed right there. And I believe we do too. We have everything spiritually that we need right among us. And these first notes of spiritual gift in the overture, they swell into one of the most famous themes in the book in chapter 12, where Paul describes that there are diversities of gift to one knowledge, to one wisdom, to one faith, all joined together in one body. And this manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all, where nobody's better than anybody else, nobody's more important than anybody else, and where we do not function by a hierarchy, but we function because of direct connection to our head, who is Jesus Christ. Unity, sanctification, richness of life, spiritual gift, and also in this overture are the notes of our future. The coming again of Jesus Christ and our sharing in his resurrection. The schedule for this series lands 1 Corinthians 15 on Easter Sunday, when we will, as we do annually, pay particular attention to the fact that Jesus Christ is raised from the dead and that he is the first of many. And the promise that is so boldly stated here in Corinthians, that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, that the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And like the crescendo of the overture we heard earlier, Paul points us forward to the coming day of the Lord Jesus Christ. Throughout the Old Testament scriptures, the prophets had spoken of what they called the day of the Lord. It's the most important prophetic event in the Old Testament. The day, or the most written of, I should say, perhaps. The day of the Lord, the righteous judgment of God upon the earth. Paul changes one word, and he changes it right here. You can see that. And instead of calling it the day of the Lord, he calls it the day of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Building on all that had been written before, and now expanding it and making it our Lord. And throughout this overture, I hope you noticed the repeated references to him. To Christ. We're sanctified in him, we fellowship in him, we're confirmed in him, we're waiting for him. And in these few verses, Paul mentions the name of Jesus Christ 9 times. They are the first 9 of 153 times that Paul will name his name in these 16 chapters. And like the great underground aquifer that feeds the springs and the lakes and the rivers that water the earth, so the work and the presence of Jesus Christ springs to the surface and enriches every day, ennobles every effort, every ministry, binds us together, even as it will do one day in the resurrection. These 9 verses, that's quite an overture. That's quite a start to this letter. Now, our time this morning is almost gone, but just one more thought before we are done, and I'd like to say something about Corinth itself, and to also thank the brethren at the breaking of bread who spoke this morning from the first words that were said and throughout. It's something as a speaker when you just sit at breaking of bread and you listen to other people preaching your message for you. I noted earlier that we can study this book as sort of a manual for the local church, and certainly it is that, and we are well served to do that, but we want to take more than that from the book, to discuss not only what are the right answers, but why they are the right answers, and how a church functions within a city, and how the gospel impacts the Hellenistic world. So let me talk about Corinth for just a minute. When Paul arrived, Corinth was a boom town. It was a cosmopolitan, pluralistic metropolis. Population about 250,000. It was the capital and the largest city of the province, much bigger than Athens. And it was replete with statues of Greek gods. When Paul was in Athens, he said something that really strikes me, and if I can be so bold, something that I think it is central for us to understand concerning the evangelism and the new discipleship he had to develop as he came into Macedonia, something central, but something we can easily miss. So also, Paul saw in Athens that the city was filled with idols. And in particular, famously, there was an altar dedicated to an unknown god. And it was much the same in Corinth, with temples throughout the city. The archaeology of the city has determined that there were temples to Poseidon and Apollo and Athena and Zeus and Hera. And actually, the list goes on, and it's quite long. Plus, there were temples and shrines to Egyptian gods, I suppose wanting to be inclusive. References to your body as a temple for the Holy Spirit would be quickly understood in Corinth. But as in Athens, there was one more. There was one temple that was dedicated, it said, to all the gods, just in case they missed somebody. Now, in the Old Testament scriptures, writing to Israel, living in its land, the prophets condemned idols, and they condemned the pagan gods in the strongest language. But here in Macedonia, Paul does something different. He doesn't condemn the people, but he spoke of those idols and temples not as their evidence of universal sin, not of their evidence of universal depravity and degradation, and not as obstacles to the gospel. He sees them rather as evidence of ignorance, and evidence of a people who were still looking and who still understood that there's something more to life out there. And in that science on steroids society, that there was a hunger for faith. They knew something was there. They just didn't know what it was. And that's how Paul approached them. Not with condemnation, but with commonality. Not with denunciation, but rather by making himself a part of their marketplace and of their society. In fact, you see what Paul says here, that God in Christ is not far from each of us. I confess that there have been times when I've thought of this person or that who I would think in our common Christian speak parlance, he's a long way from the gospel. I've heard that phrase I don't know how many times. He's a long way from the gospel. Whether by antagonism or apathy, a long way away. But that's not true. That is not true. God in Christ is not far from each of us. And rather than condemning the world, and rather than with anger or disregard or withdrawal, Paul writes to these Christians in Corinth, and through them to us, that we are to be the confirmation of the words of Jesus Christ, making our lives the confirmation of the words of Scripture that we preach to a world that is ignorant, to a world that is searching, and to men and women who, despite all appearances, are not far from God. And so now, this overture having been played, we're ready for the curtain. And next week, we will start our study in detail. We'll cover chapter 1. Our brother Matthew Gorman has the meeting. Thank you so much for listening to me today. And I trust that the Lord will bless us as we go through this series. And as we live in this society, to make ourselves a part of it, and to be the confirmation of the words of Jesus Christ unto it. Let's pray, and then we'll be done. Our Father, we thank you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ for the marvelous grace that has come to us in him. We thank you, Father, that you have placed us in this world. You have embedded us into it, that we may be the confirmation of your Son. Father, we pray for an open door, for an understanding of the gospel. We pray for the work of your Spirit, even as it did in those days. We pray, Father, that as we learn to do things ever better, and as we learn to do things well, so we may learn your heart also, and that we may bear it before the world. Father, we pray as we go into this study for excellence in the understanding of your word. We pray that we would excel in understanding, and we pray that you would open our minds, that we would understand and appreciate, and that we would do that which it says. We pray also, Father, for hearts that are responsive to your Spirit, and that the Lord Jesus Christ would be glorified. Father, we also pray for our nation. Remember in this week of transition that you rule over the affairs of men. And so we pray for our society, we pray for our people, that we would see a renewal, and that we would see your blessing in our land. We give thanks in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for joining us today, and we are dismissed.